Good morning. We'd like to invite you to have a seat as we're going to get started. Thank you very much. We are from one world with many voices standing together, singing one song. Sisters and brothers, strong in the spirit, sharing one vision. Our song. We are from one world with many voices, standing together, singing one song. Sisters and brothers, strong in the spirit. One vision, peace is our song. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Well, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the preacher, not the deacon, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the preacher, not the deacon, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. All right. Well, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Well, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my father, not my mother, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my father, not my mother, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Yeah, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Well, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
Standing. Yay. Good morning. The first thing I want to let you know is that this gorgeous flower arrangement made by Caroline, I do believe, is in honor of Ann Armour. Some of us will remember her, some of us won't. She was around here a long time ago. She had her 94th birthday yesterday, and she is now in hospice care and close to transition. So, for Ann. So welcome to Community Congregational Church, whether you're here in person or Zooming along, and wherever you are on life's journey, you're welcome here. So my name is Sandra Weil. I'm obviously your liturgist and announcer today. If you haven't already done so, please find a comfortable place to sit. For kids, and we don't have any right now, but if and when we do, we have an activity basket over in the fireside room for them. And if you're visiting us for the first time today, we'd love you to fill out a guest card and put it in the offering plate, which I understand is, I can see it, it's sitting on Raj's table back there. We invite you to stay for coffee and snacks after the service so we can get to know you better. And I have to say, and of course, all of you are welcome to stay for coffee and snacks, whether or not you're here for the first time. As always, the Friday newsletter is full of useful information. You can sign up for that if you're not already getting it by going to the website, look at the top of any page, and for the little blue icon, click on that, fill out a form, and you are subscribed. Some highlights from this week's newsletter. There's information there about the book Unpacking a History of Systemic Racism in the American Education System, and about a reading by the author of that book. Her name is Tiffany Jewell. She'll be doing a reading at the San Anselmo Public Library. There's details about upcoming Sunday celebrations and highlighted events for Pride Month, which we are in right now. A reminder that the office will be closed until next Wednesday. Dory's taking a little time off. There's details about at least two community outings coming up. One is a trip on the SMART train to Petaluma for lunch, and then another is a trip to a Giants game. So those details are in the letter. And the date for the next TASE has been set for next Sunday, June 23rd. Okay, that's it. So as you're able and willing, please stand up and greet your neighbor.
River running by the
sunset and the morning that brightens up the
sky.
All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, our dear God made them all. The cold wind in the winter, the pleasant summer sun, the ripe fruits in the garden, God made them every one. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, our dear God made them all.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
According to this song, God made you wonderful. It's good news. Yeah. I know you're not churchy people. You don't have to say amen. You could just say right on. God made you wonderful. Yeah, absolutely. So this is the time during our service where we invite prayers of intercession and thanksgiving. If you're joining us on Zoom, you're welcome to put that in the chat, and Caroline will share those with us. For those of us gathered in body or on Zoom, for whom and what do we pray today? And Jolynn will start us off. Thank you, Jolynn.
These are prayers that were sent in online. And the first is, as Sandra already mentioned, for Ann Armour, who is in transition. I remember her well, and I actually saw her several years ago, and we had a nice conversation. Oh, beloved, prayer. And for Anne Marie and the spirit of her Aunt Beryl, oh, beloved,
just a reminder that if you have a prayer that you'd rather not share out loud, you're welcome to come and light a candle. For the rest of us, for whom and what do we pray today? Dan?
For my parents and siblings and I this coming week as we complete their
reintegration. Yeah, for you, your siblings, and your parents as you complete this shift into assisted living for them on the other side of the country. Yes. So prayers for all of that. Oh, beloved. Michael.
Long list of friends that just need prayers. So Linda, Neil, Susan, Ron, and Lois.
For prayer, friends for prayers who need assistance. So Linda, Ron, Neil,
Susan,
Ron, and Lois. Okay. Oh, beloved. Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you, Barb Killey and her family, who are traveling to Norway right now. Others who we know are going to be traveling soon. Patty Mitchell is heading out tomorrow, and my beloved will be coming home Wednesday. I think I've got my days right. We'll see. For all those traveling mercies, oh, beloved. Sophie?
I know that my thing won't start until July 21st, but I wanted to say, I'm like,
so,
go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. 5 minutes.
You got it. Yeah, so Sophie is giving you a little preview. In July, she's going to be sharing a little bit about her story, and we're hoping to organize an event for folks with disabilities in the fall where you can see their artwork. Sophie specifically, though, and Caroline brought to my attention that July is Pride Disability Month.
Yeah.
So we don't want to leave folks out. Part of the process of liberation is remembering we have a big table and we want to make sure everybody's included. So you're going to get to hear some of Sophie's story in July. So I'm excited for that. So, and we're so glad you're part of this family. Oh, beloved. Sandra?
Prayers of comfort for Maria Fletcher.
Yes.
Brother Mark in, I believe it was early April.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. For Maria, who lost her brother. Oh, beloved. Mm-hmm. Yes, Scott.
Prayers for the people of Sudan.
Mm-hmm.
And Gaza and everybody who has food insecurities around the world.
Yes. Prayers for peace. For siblings in Gaza and Sudan, the Ukraine, so many places, and for all those with food insecurities. May, oh, beloved. Shannon. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So prayers for our democracy and gratitude for friends who are home and new friends who are joining us today. Oh, beloved. Yes, Anne. For Jamie, Alan, and Jean as they navigate medical situations. Oh, beloved. Me on Zoom? Doesn't look like it. Okay. A special thankful prayer for fathers, all who have been a father figure, and for those of us who are missing fathers, that we will be held in peace and love. Oh, beloved. So I invite you to join me in praying this prayer by Caitlin Curtis, a member of the Potawatomi Nation. We've shared this for the last few weeks. Join me in the words on the screen here. O Mother Mystery, comfort those who cannot be comforted by institutions that continually fail them. Comfort those whose leaders blame them for their oppression. Comfort the children, the elderly, the sick, the immunocompromised. Comfort those who no one listened to. Turn us back again to the goodness of this earth, that we may remember what it means to be in awe, even when the days are difficult. Give us the urgency to practice our communal calling as people, to decolonize our ways of individualistic selfishness. Draw us together to you, to the vision of a better way. We rest in holy goodness. We rest in knowing that the seasons will change. Amen.
Day by day, day by day, oh dear Lord, three things I pray, to see thee more clearly, love thee more dearly, follow thee more nearly day by day, day by day, day by day. Oh, dear Lord, three things I pray. To see thee more clearly, love thee more dearly, follow thee more nearly, day by day, by day, by day, by day.
Amen. Thank you for that. Oh, go ahead, Sandra. I'm totally, this is why I don't know what day it is. That's all right.
So the first reading is actually a repeat of the one we heard last week. We must need to really hear this. This is Psalm 139. Is it happening? Okay. Oh God, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O God, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such connection is too wonderful for me. It is so vast that I cannot fully understand it. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am amazingly and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depth of the earth. Your eyes beheld my substance. In your book were written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them as yet existed. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. I try to count them. They are more than the sand. I come to the end. I am still with you. And then another sacred text, a poem called Jesus at the Gay Bar by Jay Hulme. He's here in the midst of it, right at the center of the dance floor, robes hitched up to his knees to make it easy to spin. At some point in the evening, a boy will touch the hem of his robe and beg to be healed, beg to be anything other than this. And he will reach his arms out, sweat damped and weary from dance. He'll cup the boy's face in his hand and say, my beautiful child, there is nothing in this heart or body of yours that ever needs to be healed.
So Sandra mentioned at the beginning of our service that we're celebrating Pride Month this month, and we've been able to hear a testimony from Barbara Buckley, from Barb Hargrave last week, and this week we're going to hear from Michael Peters. And many of you know Michael, and I'm so grateful that he's willing to share his story today. And I just want to remind you again that just like there is no one else like you, there is no one else like Michael. So even though you're hearing from a gay man who's white and however else Michael identifies, not all white gay men are the same. And also, Michael doesn't know all the gay men, in case you're wondering. You know, sometimes people say, oh, I know somebody gay, do you know so-and-so? We actually don't have a map of everyone. That's a common myth. Anyways, thank you, Michael, for sharing your story today.
Fortune. The word has various meanings. It can describe a large amount of money or assets, But more importantly, perhaps, it means luck as an external, arbitrary force affecting human beings. I consider myself very fortunate. Now, you could argue that good fortune is not arbitrary. Perhaps my fortune, or your fortune for that matter, is the universe aligning correctly. Perhaps it is a guardian angel, or angels, guiding things in the right way for us. I happen to have saved every single slip of paper from inside a fortune cookie for my entire adult life. There's a wooden box in the bedroom filled with them. I save them in my wallet when dining at a Chinese restaurant, and then they get added to the box each month, and every once in a while I will post one on social media. So here are a few of the most recent ones, some positive affirmation or direction in life. I'm not terribly superstitious, and I couldn't tell you what caused me to start collecting these some 40 years ago, but I do believe today that despite many bumps in the road, I have been fortunate. When it comes to my life, in particular my coming out of the closet as a gay man, I have also been fortunate. It took me a while to accept things myself. I wasn't necessarily scared to come out, but I just didn't deal with it until my mid-20s. I was too busy or too unsure, perhaps. I never dated in high school or college. I just lived my life bouncing off occasional offers from women and sometimes men, especially since I did hang with quite a few open gays and lesbians. Working in theater, I was exposed to a lot of very open and proud individuals. But each of us must deal with it in their own time. I don't have many regrets in life, but looking back now, knowing what a fairly easy process it was going to be for me, I do wish that I had done it earlier in my life. I have so much respect for young people nowadays who are able to come out earlier in their lives. My process started when I was 25 years old, and my mother was the first person that I told. I could not have had any more support. Here it comes. I could not have had any more support from a loving parent. Mom was unconditional in her love, but she went way above and beyond that. Over the next 25 years, Mom would become a fierce advocate for LGBT plus rights. She went across Northern California wearing her proud mom shirts, speaking her mind, fighting the fight for equality, conveying her messages of unconditional love to other parents. What a joy. I recognize that not all young gay men have this type of support from within their families. I was fortunate. After coming out to her, Mom suggested that I seek counsel. Growing up in a Christian household, going to private school, having my head filled with a lot of Bible lessons, I had questions. I didn't necessarily have fears of what God would think of me, which is what I often hear from other people's testimonials. But I needed to find a balance between my sexuality and my faith. I was introduced to the pastor at the United Methodist Church in Chico, where I was living at the time. Pastor Ellen became my counselor, my mentor, and my spiritual awakener. We would sit in her office week after week, as I developed a new sense of self-appreciation, of living an open and honest life, and gaining an understanding of my faith journey up until that point in my life. How fortunate to have found such a clergy member. Over the next year, I became active in the church, singing in the choir, catering dinners, teaching Sunday school, directing youth theater productions. But in a congregation of close to 300, I was still only out to a select few. Then, during one congregational meeting, the church was going to vote on how their statement of welcome was going to be worded. It was apparent that the vote of including the words accepting of all people regardless of their age, ethnicity, social status, sexual identity, on and on, was going to lose to the blanket statement of all are welcome. This church's heart was in the right place, but the congregation felt like we didn't need to be so specific. I looked at Pastor Ellen, and she nodded to me, and I asked to get up and speak. I came out in front of the entire congregational meeting, and I expressed my opinion, which was that too many churches use the words, "We welcome all," or "all of God's children are welcome here," but they don't always mean it. Often the intention of religious institutions is to open their arms, but attempt to change you. Too frequently during my life, I have met young people who were convinced into going into conversion therapy, or constantly being told that their sinful ways had to be changed. It was important that we as a church represented ourselves clearly without question. The congregation sided with me and voted for the very descriptive statement of welcome that included regardless of sexual orientation. What a joy to be a part of a community that accepted me for who I truly was. How fortunate for me, knowing that so many other young LGBT plus people of spiritual upbringing aren't so lucky, and that they have to abandon their faith, or worse, contemplate ending their lives because they believe God isn't on their side. At that point in my life, I had a mother who supported me, a church family that loved me. I was very active in the Chico gay scene, interfaith support groups, AIDS fundraisers, a very tight-knit family of gays and allies at the local club scene. But where I was hesitant to come out was at my place of work. Chico, much like many rural places across our state and country, can have many closed-minded, backwater, if you will, people who are not open to gays. I was working in a variety of capacities for a family-owned natural food store, in charge of store marketing and later promoted to assistant manager, and I developed a barbecue takeout restaurant for them. We had an area of picnic tables behind the building, and often the owner of the store, who was a rough, single, country man with a hankering for the ladies, he would sit out at those tables with other staff members. And as we were winding down one day, closing up the barbecue, we'd sit at those tables, have a drink or two, and talk about everything. One evening I joined them at his request, and we must have sat there for several hours, close to midnight, talking and laughing. And he got up from the table, went around towards the front of the store, and the other employees and I continued talking. After some time passed, I said, "You know, I'm going to go check on Rich." I walked around to the front of the store, and there in the middle of the empty parking lot was Rich, sitting on the ground, having had a few too many drinks. He saw me, reached out his arms, and he said, "Michael, come on over here." I joined him, and we sat there looking at the large sign in front of the store, all lit up at nighttime. He says, "Oh, isn't this store beautiful?" He says, I just love it. I love all the people who made this happen. I just love people. I don't care if they're black or white, straight or gay." I have no idea if he was speaking to me directly, but they say the truth comes out sometimes when you've had a little too much to drink. I realized I had nothing. The very next day, the Rainbow Pride sticker went on the back of my truck. No more living in fear. I shared the joy of who I was to everyone. I was out and proud and even became more active in the gay scene and gay causes. A few years later, as I was managing a large apartment complex, I got to know our postal delivery person very well. We had these security cameras at the front of the property, and I could always see from my office in the middle of the complex when she pulled her postal van up to the bank of mailboxes. So for almost 2 years, it became a routine thing that we would meet at the mailboxes and just talk. She would often time it so that she could take her lunch break, arriving when she did at our complex. First, it was just a social thing, but over time, it became so much more, talking about the status of the world, about religion, she was raised Mormon, and about things that were pressing on both of our minds. I cherished this 15 to 30 minutes encounter every 5 days of the week. One day she presented me with a gift, a little something wrapped up tight. I opened it and was overjoyed with her thoughtfulness. It was this little magnet, born gay, fabulous by choice. I consider this one of the greatest presents I've ever received. But someone coming from a different upbringing, a different religion, a different mindset about the gay community, could have had that she had a change of heart and could gift something like this. And I was invited to her wedding the following year. What a joy. What a fortune. Even being so out and proud for the last 27 years of my life, I acknowledge how many others don't have the same fortune as me. I can count on one hand how many times someone has shouted a slur at me. Although I wish we lived in a world where that number was zero, I am fortunate that it's only been a handful of times compared to the LGBT plus people who must constantly withstand a bombardment of hatred, nasty slurs, bullying, or physical abuse. My best friend who lives in Los Angeles has been physically beaten a number of times just for how he presents himself, right here in California. Other countries where gays must hide their true selves, face religious and government persecution, get ostracized from their families, face torture and even death. I am thankful. I am thankful for where I live, for this community, for my friends, for being able to walk with my husband hand in hand in public. We remember Matthew Shepard, the young man who was taken from a bar in Laramie, Wyoming, beaten by two young men, left to die, tied to a fence post out in a field. It was 26 years ago this happened. And although gay rights have come a long way since then, there is still so much more work to do. I've had the pleasure of hearing Matthew's mom, Judy, speak many times. She devoted her life since his murder to traveling the world and speaking out about her son's journey, and for legislating for hate crime bills, for encouraging other parents to love their gay children, and for encouraging everyone to come out and stay out because it makes a difference. Here I am with Matthew's father and mother, what remarkable people to devote their lives to helping others after such a tragedy. Matthew is no doubt an angel doing his best to guide others into better fortune. And I know that my mother, Betty, is also doing the same. I feel her guidance in my life, and I know that she's making an impact in other people's lives. How fortunate.
I hope you can draw the line from being a parent or a grandparent who says, "Why wouldn't I love you?" to being a faith community who says, "How could we not celebrate you?" to then being part of organizations who say, "Of course, equal rights are the least we could do to fight for, to advocate for, to have conversations for." If you're wondering still why it's important that we are an open and affirming congregation, I hope this gives you a little bit of that nudge of why this matters. In the office, for those of you that saw it last week, you may have missed this on the wall behind Dory's desk. You can go and see it. Is the plaque that we were gifted from the national setting when this church voted, I think roughly 25 years ago, to become an open and affirming congregation. That's a significant step. In the United Church of Christ, for as progressive a denomination as we talk about being, still only 30% of congregations have voted to become open and affirming. 30%. Lots of them have the conversations, well, can't we just say we welcome all? Why do we need to be so specific? We talked about that some last week in connection to the Black Lives Matter movement. For people who say, well, all lives matter, yes, but in this moment, part of our community is hurting, and we need to address that pain. So in a couple of weeks, I'll tell you a little bit more about that. I want to invite you to see the process of being open and affirming as just that, as a process, not a destination. Because even though 30% of congregations vote to become open and affirming, so many of them get the plaque and then say, we're done, we've done our work, we did the thing, we're good. In that line that you, I hope, connect the dots to Michael's story and your own story, I hope you also see that when you choose a pastor who is out, you make it easier for people who have been marginalized to feel safe. That's a choice you made. That's a choice you made. Not just, well, we want a gay male pastor who's not too gay. We're okay with a white lesbian pastor who's not too lesbian. You picked a crazy non-binary pastor who's mixed. And some days I come to work here and I think, what were you people thinking? You were thinking, Spirit is leading through this thread and there's more work to be done. And I'm grateful for that. Last week we talked about paradigms of how we see ourselves and how we see others. And I invite you to consider this as ongoing work. Liberation is ongoing work, not a destination. So I'm going to invite you to listen to this reading again, the second reading, Jesus at the Gay Bar. It's one of my favorites. I can't tell you how many times I've gotten choked up by it. You can close your eyes if that's easier for you. I want you really to picture, to become embodied in this text as I read it for you. Take a breath. Let your body settle in. Use your imagination to picture this scene. He's here in the midst of it, right at the center of the dance floor, robes hitched up to his knees to make it easy to spin. At some point in the evening, a boy will touch the hem of his robe and beg to be healed, beg to be anything other than this. And we'll reach his arms out, sweat damped and weary from the dance. He'll cup the boy's face in his hands and say, my beautiful child. My beautiful child. There is nothing in this heart of yours that ever needs to be healed. You may not identify as gay, but my guess is that you have, like all of us, received messages that you should be self-loathing. That there is some part of yourself you should hate. Some part of yourself that should be changed. Some part of yourself that if you just correct it, would be so much better and acceptable to everyone else. And that's a lie. It's a lie that so often we take and internalize and think we're finding our healing, we've gotten over that, but then we enact that trauma on each other. I would imagine most of us, when we read that poem, because of the way we've been programmed, see the gay boy as white. And if I went a little farther, I think most of us see Jesus as white in that poem, or at least light-skinned. Unconscious bias is the way our brain gravitates towards decision-making, because a white gay boy is a whole lot safer than a dark-skinned drag queen. And that changes the whole poem for us, because we haven't truly dealt with our own self-loathing. The truth is when I get free, I'm more likely to cheer for you to be fully free too. And hopefully, as you get more free, you're cheering for me to be myself, to come out on the dance floor, to dance, to be fully who I am, because that's what liberation does. But we're being taught that this message of liberation is one person gets the power and nobody else gets to have the power. That's not liberation. Becoming free is ongoing work. It's not a destination. I want to read this poem again, and I want to invite you to see yourself in this scene. I want to invite you to picture yourself in this poem. Because how you see the gay community is actually more about you and less about us. In fact, it's probably more about the messages you received, about your own body. So I invite you to picture yourself in your imagination. I'll read this again. Take a breath with me and let your body settle. He's here in the midst of it, right in the center of the dance floor, robes hitched up to his knees to make it easy to spin. At some point in the evening, a boy will touch the hem of his robe and beg to be healed. Beg to be anything other than this. And he'll reach his arms out, sweat damped and weary from the dance. He'll cup the boy's face in his hands and say, "My beautiful child, there is nothing in this heart of yours that ever needs to be healed." Notice where you are in that scene. Are you an onlooker, curious? Are you the boy wanting to be different? Are you Jesus, exhausted from having so much fun and waiting, wanting so badly for the person before you to be free, to dance with you? The work of living into being an open and affirming church is a process, not a destination. When I was in seminary, I remember hearing statistics that it's more likely for a white pastor to get a call to a multicultural church than it is for a person with more melanin to get called to a church that is predominantly white. Let me say that again. It's more common for a white pastor to be called to a church that calls itself multicultural than for a person with more melanin to be called to a congregation that's predominantly white. We have some work to do on our bias, on who we will listen to, on who we will take instruction from, on who we will learn with and alongside. I hope you heard in Michael's story that when you make space for queer people to do that, we do that naturally at mailboxes, in parking lots, because you are already doing that work. You make it so much simpler for others to do it too. This matters because it's not just the boy who needs freedom in the poem, it's all of us. Audre Lorde is best known for saying that our liberation is collective. When you find joy in being you, there's room for others to have joy too. One of our favorite musicians in the last couple years is named Mariba, and she has this song, and it's forever like etched in my brain, and it comes back to me at these very specific times. And I've written some like spoken word pieces about it because it's been so impactful. But the line that she repeats in one particular song is, "I didn't come to get by, I came to get free. I didn't come here to get by, I came here to get free." That is the invitation for all of us. Don't waste your time just trying to get by. Get free.
You can turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast to be the backlash of somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way the words do when they settle neath your skin. Kept on the inside and no sunlight, sometimes the shadow wins. But I wonder what would happen if you say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave with what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave, just wanna see you, I just wanna see you. Just wanna see you, I wanna see you be brave. Wanna see you, I just wanna see you. Just wanna see you, I wanna see you be brave. Everybody's been there, everybody's been stared down by the enemy. All over the fear and done some disappearing, bound out to the mighty. Don't run, stop holding your tongue. Maybe one of these days you can let the light in. Maybe there's a way out of the cage where you live. Show me how big your brave is. Say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. What you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. Ever since your history of silence won't do you any good, did you think it would? Let your words be anything but empty. Oh, won't you tell them the truth? What you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave with what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. Wanna see you, I just wanna see you. Just wanna see you. Just wanna see you, I just wanna see you, I just wanna see you, I wanna see you be brave.
Thank you. Thank you, Zuri. Thank you. I'm going to offer you a blessing, and then we'll stand for our circle song. And I want to remind you about the offering plate. If you'd like to support the work that we're doing here, thank you for the ways you're doing that. You're welcome also to stay for coffee hour. Johan has brought a huge wealth of treats, and to say hello to our friends on Zoom. And then lastly, next Sunday, you may have seen the posters up or gotten the email invitation. Next Sunday, we're having that special screening of We're Here after the 10 o'clock service. So there's going to be food, games. It's a great time to invite your friends if you've been wanting to share with them what we do here. And Michael is going to be hosting and facilitating that time. So let me offer this blessing for you. I'm going to ask you to do something a little weird. You should be used to this by now. I want to invite you to touch your face. Just touch your own face. You might remember a time when a loving parent or a loving adult did that. May you know and remember that you are good, that you are beloved. There is nothing that you're holding right now that makes you any less of the beloved. May it be so. Let's stand together and sing.